you do when your child moves away from home for the first time, maybe to go out to college, far from home, and you're worried. Worried about how they're going to do, how they're going to manage without you there to set up their room, to help them get their prescriptions filled, to navigate the registration process as they enroll in school, perhaps, or to coordinate their rides to and from the airport for those holidays when they come home, or when you're not there to comfort them when they're sick, or to encourage them when they're lonely. Well, here's what you do if you're a really good parent. You hire a concierge service that specializes in providing parental support for students who live far away from their parents. I mean, it's really a thing. I read about it this past week. Concierge services for students, for example, out of Boston, charges just $10,000 per academic year to come alongside your college student and alleviate you of any worry and anxiety that you might have about your children being on their own for the first time. You know who else could have used the concierge service? The Apostle Paul. But not for his biological children, for his spiritual children. The churches that he had planted throughout the ancient Mediterranean world, like the one we've been looking at in Thessalonica over the past few weeks. When you read his first letter to that church, a church that he had only recently planted, but he had to leave shortly thereafter because of the persecution that breaks out against the church, he sounds like a stressed-out parent, worrying about how his kids are going to manage without him being there. And so we read in chapter 2, for example, verses 17 through 20, "But brothers and sisters, when we were orphaned by being separated from you for a short time, in person, not in thought, out of our intense longing, we made every effort to see you. For we wanted to come to you, certainly I, Paul, did again and again, but Satan blocked our way. For what is our hope, our joy, or the crown in which we will glory in the presence of our Lord Jesus when He comes? Is it not you? Indeed, you are our glory and joy." Well, Paul doesn't have the benefit of an ancient concierge service to watch over the church in his absence. So he does the next best thing, and that is to send his apprentice Timothy to the church. So he says, "So when we could stand it no longer, we thought it best to be left by ourselves in Athens. We sent Timothy." Now, when Paul says "we" there in verse 1 of chapter 3, he's referring to himself only. He's using the third person to refer to himself. He's saying, "When I could stand it no longer," talking about his concern for that church, "when I could stand it no longer, I thought it best to be left by myself." Now, Paul does not want to be left alone. He very much depends upon the support and upon the encouragement of his fellow missionaries. But the well-being of the church in Thessalonica is of far greater importance to him than his own needs, his own wants. And why is he so concerned about the well-being of that church, about how strong and secure they are in their faith? Well, it's because he knows what that church is facing. He knows that they are going to face some big-time challenges, challenges in the form of false teaching, in the form of persecution. And he knows that if they don't stand firm in the face of these challenges, they're going to fall right back in again into the slavery of sin and estrangement from God. For as the Bible says in Hebrews, it is impossible to bring back to repentance those who were once enlightened, those who have experienced the good things of heaven and shared in the Holy Spirit, who have tasted the goodness of the Word of God and the power of the age to come, and who then turn away from God. It is impossible to bring such people back to repentance. Stakes are high. Stand firm in the faith. the stakes are still high for Christ followers. Because the challenges facing the church, whether it's in the first century, are still the same facing the church in the 21st century. For example, Christians suffer. Christians suffer. And we're not talking about the kind of suffering that comes from living in a fallen and broken world. Although Christians are not immune from that kind of suffering, as you well know. But that is not the kind of suffering that Paul is talking about in this letter. He's talking about the kind of suffering that comes as a direct result of following Christ. And when I say following Christ, I mean in the kind of manner where following Christ is clearly making a difference in how you live your life. Because if following Christ is not impacting how you live your life, then you're really not following Christ. Don't fool yourself. And in that case, you're really not a threat to the powers of this age. But those who take following Christ seriously, they are a threat to the powers of this age. And they are the ones who are likely to face persecution because they are Christ followers. You see, Christians in cities like Thessalonica or in the city of Ephesus, they're not being persecuted simply because they call themselves Christians. They're being persecuted because their faith is impacting how they live their life. For example, following Christ is impacting how they spend their money. In Ephesus, for example, converts to Christ are no longer buying the idols made by the silversmiths of that area. And it is negatively impacting the community economically, and people are not happy. Following Christ is impacting how new converts relate to the emperor. No longer do these Christians see the emperor as sovereign, but Christ alone. An allegiance to Christ above any earthly authority is always viewed as subversive by the powers of this age. Following Christ impacts how these Christians interact and view other people. No longer do Christians see a person's worth as defined by their social standing, but instead by the mere fact of their creation in the image of God. And that kind of view, that upsets social hierarchies. So Christians who take following Christ seriously are generally viewed as a threat by the powers of this age. And the powers of this age push back. Not a question of if, but when. And when they do, when the powers of this age push back, it can make you think twice about following Christ, or at least following Him in any distinguishable kind of way. Well, that's the reason that Paul sends Timothy to the church in Thessalonica. He's sending Timothy to encourage the church so that no one would be unsettled by these trials. For you know quite well that we are destined for them. In fact, when we were with you, in that short time that Paul was with that church, we kept telling you that we would be persecuted. And it turned out that way, as you well know. I think it's very interesting that in the short time Paul is with that church, he's already stressing the likelihood of persecution that will break out against these new believers. Basically, he tells them from the very beginning, if you accept what I am telling you about Jesus Christ, that He is the Messiah, if you accept, if you embrace, if you put your faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, here's what you can expect. You will suffer. You will face persecution. Now, I got to be honest with you. I typically don't lead with that when I begin telling somebody about Jesus Christ. A lot of us don't. We don't commonly start with persecution as a likely prospect for people who might put their faith in Jesus. Why not? Well, maybe because in our context, we've not had to suffer or to face any real persecution as Christ followers. Now, we know that happens, but it's more in the abstract because it happens to Christians in faraway places like North Korea or in China, Iran, places like that. According to the Open Doors International's 2022 World Watch List, which ranks the 50 most dangerous countries for Christians, an average of 13 Christians are murdered every single day because of their faith, because they're Christ followers. We don't face that kind of persecution here anywhere close to it. But that doesn't mean things aren't changing. In a book that came out just this year called Resilient, Standing Firm in a Hostile World, author David Young identifies some of the ways that those who are opposed to Christianity are turning up the heat against people of faith. In our context, one way is through increased propaganda and disinformation that is serving to discredit and undermine, quote, biblical views of life, of truth, of justice, of religious freedom, and of sex and family. Another way is through increased scorning and shaming of those who hold to biblical views of morality and truth. Supreme Court Justice Samuel Alito proved prophetic in 2015 when he said, in response to the majority opinion in the Obergefell case legalizing same-sex marriage, quote, those who cling to the old beliefs will be able to whisper their thoughts in the recesses of their home. But if they repeat those views in public, they will risk being labeled as bigots and treated as such by governments, employers, schools. Discrimination is another tactic increasingly used to muzzle, to silence Christians, to silence those who hold to and espouse biblical views. They can often find themselves barred from teaching positions in higher education, marginalized in medical and legal associations, blackballed in the entertainment industry. Lawsuits and fines are increasingly threatened against Christian business owners or against prospective adoptive parents who are Christian, or against Christian nonprofits, against any Christians or Christian organizations that dare to live out and run their lives in association by the convictions of their faith. Now, thankfully, the First Amendment has held strong, but even so, just that threat of lawsuit, fines, can result in many Christians choosing to self-censor, to tone down their convictions, their beliefs, lest they provoke the wrath and ire of those who are not shy in their opposition to Christianity. Paul knows it is not going to be easy for these new followers of Christ in Thessalonica. He knows that because they're going to suffer for following Christ, not only for that reason, he knows that Christians struggle. For this reason, when I could stand it no longer, I sent to find out about your faith. I was afraid that in some way the tempter had tempted you and that our labors might have been in vain. Yes, Satan will seek to use their sufferings as leverage to turn their hearts away from Christ. But it's not just suffering. It's not just persecution that the evil one will use. He will use whatever means at his disposal to turn hearts that were once on fire for Christ, to turn them to cold, whether it be temptations of the flesh, discouragements of the soul, despair of the mind, whatever it takes. You see, in our struggles, there is a temptation to compromise behavior so that we can fit in. For example, you may choose to just go along with the tone of conversations at work or at school, even though the tone betrays the kind of speech that God calls us to. Don't use foul or abusive language. Let everything you say be good and helpful, so that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them. In our struggles, there's often a temptation to fall back into pre-Christian behavior, or to turn to those things, those substances that might numb and distract, rather than trusting in what God provides us to encourage us, to sustain us, to help us overcome our struggles. Resources like the Holy Spirit. Don't get drunk with wine, the Bible says, because that will ruin your life. Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit. Resources like God Himself. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray. Go to God about everything. Resources like one another. Share each other's burdens. And in this way, obey the law of Christ. In our struggles, there is sometimes a temptation to give up. Give up the faith. Paul knows that was a temptation for the church in Thessalonica. It's a temptation the church still faces. I wonder, he says to the Galatians, let's not get tired of doing what is good. At just the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessing if we don't give up. The question that Paul has for the Thessalonians is the same question that stands before us today. Will you stand firm? Will you stand firm? So far, it's looking good for the Thessalonians. They are standing firm. Paul says in chapter 3, Timothy has just now come to us from you and has brought good news about your faith and love. Now we really live since you are standing firm in the Lord. Yeah, the persecutions, the challenges can threaten to unsettle your faith, but so far that church is standing firm. The question is, will you stand firm? Well, you will if you continue to hold fast to biblical teaching. That's why Paul sends Timothy to the church. We sent Timothy, who is our brother and co-worker in God's service in spreading the gospel of Christ, to strengthen and encourage you. Well, how does Timothy do that? How does he strengthen and encourage the church? It's through the teaching of God's Word. Later in chapter 5, Paul challenges the church to honor the leaders of the church. And one of the ways that a church honors her leaders is by taking advantage of the teaching and preaching provided by the leaders. Teaching and preaching of the Word, just like Timothy provided the Thessalonians. Why is that so important? Because it is through the Word of God that God speaks to us, that He challenges us, that He convicts us, that He sometimes rebukes us, but that He reminds us of His promises. He lifts us up, holds us fast. You'll stand firm also if you make the most of church fellowship, of gathering with brothers and sisters in Christ. He says in verse 12, may the Lord make your love increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else, just as ours does for you. That's Paul's prayer for the church in Thessalonica, that they would love and care and take care of one another. But in order for that church to be answered, the church has to make the most of opportunities to grow as followers of Christ alongside other growing followers of Christ. We can't do this alone. Live in peace, he says, with each other. And we urge you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive, encourage the disheartened, help the weak, be patient with everyone. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. We don't grow in Christ as little islands. We grow better together, taking up our part to encourage others in their walk with Christ as they encourage. others accountable within their faith as they hold us accountable. Challenging them as they challenge us. Serving others as they serve us. That's what a healthy church fellowship looks like. But you can only benefit from that kind of culture. You can only contribute to that kind of culture when you are actively engaged in the life of the church. Showing up when the church gathers. Taking part in a small group. Being there for one another. You also stand firm. You'll stand firm if you lean into God's help. He says in verse 13 of chapter 3, may He, talking about God, may He strengthen your heart so that you will be blameless and holy in the presence of our God and Father when our Lord Jesus comes with all His holy ones. God provides all the help that we need. We've got to lean into it. And we do that by rejoicing always. We will if we remind ourselves of His many promises and the ones He's fulfilled as we pray continually, always going to Him, giving thanks in all circumstances, seeing what God might do through our circumstances. For this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do not quench the Spirit, He says. Do not treat prophecies with contempt. What's He talking about? How do we quench the Spirit? We quench the Spirit when we do not take advantage of the most important resource He provides to speak to us, the Word of God. It's like a kink in a hose. The water can't get through. The Spirit can't get through if we are not in God's Word. Even without Paul's presence, the church in Thessalonica was not left to fend for itself. And neither are we. Neither are you. Because even though you may suffer as a result of following Christ, even though you may struggle at times in your walk with Christ, in Christ, though, you have everything you need to stand firm. And ultimately, it is God who holds you up if you hang on to Him through those means that He provides, His Word, His church, and Himself. Paul says, may God Himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus. The one who calls you is faithful. He will do it. Now, all of this talk of suffering and struggle, it may leave you wondering. You may be questioning, am I going to stand firm? Am I going to be among those who is found standing firm when Christ returns, when all is said and done? The answer is, sure you will. If you continue to trust and to lean into what God provides. In fact, it's leaning into Him and into what He provides to stand firm that weakens the threat that suffering and struggle poses to your faith. As many Christ followers around the world have discovered, even in those most persecuted of places. In that book I just mentioned, Resilient, author David Young writes, in my many interviews of church leaders in persecuted areas, they are among the most happiest people I've known. They're not down. They're not in despair. They really don't talk that much about their oppressive governments. It's not that big of a deal to them. Rather than worrying about persecution, these Christians are busy thinking about how to win their persecutors to Jesus. And this explains why the gospel is exploding in places, even today, difficult places even today, China, India, Iran, across Muslim Africa. The Christians in these hostile areas have not conceded the story of God to other stories. Instead, they are joyfully living in God's story. Joyfully live in God's story is to stand firm regardless of whatever challenges the world throws your way. The question is, are you living in God's story? Have you put your faith in the one He sent into this world to save you from your sins? And the one who gives new life, and the one who rescues darkness into His light. not said yes to Jesus, I want to encourage you to say yes to Jesus today, to put your faith in Him, to be united with Him in baptism. That can happen today. Just come up and make your decision known to one of our leaders after the service. You have put your faith in Christ. Are you continuing to find joy in His story above all other stories by continuing to trust and follow Him no matter how hard the world might push back? The truth is, things are changing. It is a different world. Suffering for following Christ is probably going to become more common in our culture. Will be a struggle at times. But the church of Christ will prevail. The resurrection of Jesus Christ already affirms that, but will you prevail with her, with the church, when Christ returns? Well, you will if you continue to stand firm in Christ by soaking up His Word, by actively participating in the fellowship of the church, leaning into God's help. Always. Dear Heavenly Father, Your Holy Spirit knows every challenge every follower of Christ in this fellowship may be experiencing right now. Some may be experiencing pushback because they are not shy about the one they put their hope in. Others may be struggling in different ways. But Lord, we thank You that You do not leave us alone. You do not leave us to fend for ourselves. You provide all we need to stand firm.